So welcome at this presentation of the breeding research of the conservation of the Friesian horse, where we will select against genetic disorders and conserve genetic diversity within the Friesian horse. I will first introduce ourselves, and then I will explain why we are performing this research, and then the content of the research. So, who are we? I am Marije Steensma. I performed a Bachelor and Master of Animal Sciences at Wageningen University. I graduated last year, and then in August I started to work at Wageningen University. I will start with this research next month, and this research will take 4 years. Next to that, I have a passion for Friesian horse breeding, and together with my father, currently I breed now one Friesian foal per year. During this research, I will be supervised with three researchers from Wageningen University. That is Bart Ducrot. He is also present here, so he can also answer some of your questions. He is specialized in horse breeding and population genetics. Next to that, I will be supervised by Harmen Doekes and Martijn Derks. They are not present here, but Harmen Doekes is specialized in inbreeding management, and Martijn Derks is specialized in genomics, so all about DNA information and how to read that. And together, we will combine the specializations, and we hope that this research will be a success. This research is in collaboration with the KFPS Stadboek and also with the Dr. Van Haringen Laboratorium in Wageningen that is performing parentage control, not only of horses, but also of cattle and pigs. It also performs the DNA test, so it identifies the carriers of hydrocephalus and dwarfism. And it also performs genotypes, and I will explain that later in the PowerPoint presentation. So the motivation of this research, why is this research important? Some of you may know that the Friesian horse is inbred and has low genetic diversity. The Friesian horse population has passed severe bottlenecks. And as we can see here, that is a decrease in the population followed by an increase. And with that, we lose a lot of genetic diversity. What happened in the Friesian horse in the early 20th century, only 500 breeding mares and 3 breeding stallions have left. And the current population contains of around 8,000 breeding mares and 100 stallions. So you can imagine that the current population is partly sharing the same DNA because they all come from these 500 breeding mares and 3 breeding stallions in the past. Next to that, it's a closed population for multiple decades. That means that it is not allowed to breed with other horses than the Friesian horse. So other breeds are not allowed to breed with. That is also, it keeps a low genetic diversity. And there is an intensive use of limited number of popular breeding sires in the past, but also currently, and that also is leading to low genetic diversity. So what do we know now? The KFPS has registered the pedigree information quite well over generations. So therefore, we can calculate the inbreeding rate per generation. That is the increase in average inbreeding level per generation. And for a horse, we take a generation for 10 years. The FAO, there are some guidelines for the inbreeding rate. An inbreeding rate higher than 1% means dangerous. That means that there is a high risk on genetic disorders, and it is dangerous for the population to exist. Then an inbreeding rate between 0.5 and 1% is high, so there is still a high chance of genetic disorders. An inbreeding rate between 0.25 and 0.5 is moderate, and an inbreeding rate of lower than 0.25 is low. They advise now to have an inbreeding rate lower than 1% per generation, and preferably lower than 0.5. What we see in a Friesian horse is that for several generations, the inbreeding rate was too high, so it exceeded much more than this 1%. Therefore, there was also a high risk for the increase of genetic for the risk of genetic disorders. We can now see that the last 20 years, so the last two generations, the inbreeding rate is lower than this 1%, but it's still above 0.5. So we still, there is still a risk on the occurrence of genetic disorders. You can also see that from 1920s, the inbreeding only rate only increased per generation. It doesn't mean that it's definitely bad, but when the inbreeding rate is too high, then there is too much risk for genetic disorders. But when you constrain the inbreeding rate per generation, even if it increases, but if it is constrained below 1% or even below 0.5%, there is also possibility for the population to recover because new mutations can also introduce new genetic variation. Okay, so what is inbreeding? Inbreeding is the mating of related parents. These parents share at least one common ancestor and partly the same DNA information. So each gene is built with two alleles. So here we express one gene, which is built up from two alleles, and the horse contains around 20,000 genes. So this is one gene expressed, and take this the stallion and this the mare. If these parents are related with each other, they share a common ancestor, and that is expressed here. And when these parents are related, there is a possibility that for a certain gene, they can inherit the same DNA information. So the stallion and the mare, if they are related, they can have the same DNA information for a certain gene. If then these related parents will mate, then one of these alleles from both parents will be transmitted to their offspring. So it could be possible that this parent transmits the dark blue allele to the offspring, and this parent transmits the light blue allele to the offspring. Then this offspring does not have the same DNA information for this gene, and then the offspring is heterozygous. But it could also be that this parent transmits the red allele, so the same DNA information, to the offspring, and also the other parent transmits the same DNA information to the offspring. Then this offspring will be homozygous, so it gets for a certain gene the same DNA information from mother and father, and that is only possible when the parents are related. And when it's homozygous, it gets the same DNA information, and then there's also less genetic diversity within this animal. Okay, this is not working. Yeah. Then we also know that everyone, like humans, horses, also other animals, and also the Friesian horse, has some mistakes in their DNA. Around 3% of the DNA contains some mistakes, and these mistakes are also transmitted to the offspring. There is only a very small chance that the same mistakes in the parents occur, because every animal has mistakes on another gene. But related parents may have the same mistakes, and then there is risk of occurrence of genetic disorders. So for example, this is also expressed for one gene. One gene contains of two alleles. If it is a capital A and a lower A, when this lower A contains some mistakes, then it could be a deleterious allele. And most of the time, these are recessive monogenic diseases. So the genetic disorder will only be visible if it has two of these deleterious alleles. So this horse has a deleterious allele and a healthy allele, then this horse is just healthy, but it can transmit the deleterious allele to the offspring. If these horses are related, as we can see here, then there's possibility that they share the same deleterious allele. Then it can happen that both deleterious allele from the stallion and from the mare will be transmitted to the offspring. Then this offspring has two deleterious alleles, and then a genetic disorder can occur. So inbreeding causes expression of genetic disorders. It also causes inbreeding depression, so lower fertility. lower durability, but also a lower life expectancy. And it also causes less genetic diversity because inbreeding is sharing the same DNA information. And due to less genetic diversity, we also have a limited genetic progress in the population. In the Friesian horse, we also know that there are some genetic disorders in the population. I think many of you know dwarfism and hydrocephalus, but also dysstichiasis, which are hairs on the cornea, and then it can also lead to blindness, for example. These three genetic disorders are monogenic recessive. This means that the disorder is only expressed when the offspring gets the deleterious allele from both parents. So for example, when the stallion and a mare, if they are carrier, so they carry one deleterious allele and one healthy allele, they transmit random one allele to the offspring. It can happen that the stallion transmits the healthy allele to the offspring, and also the mare transmits the healthy allele to the offspring. Then the offspring will be free of any diseases and will also not carry any deleterious alleles. It is also possible that the stallion transmits the deleterious allele to the offspring and the mare transmits a healthy allele to the offspring. Then you get a carrier animal, so they have one healthy and one deleterious allele. These horses don't express the genetic disorder, but they have one deleterious allele, so they can transmit it to the offspring. The genetic disorder only comes to expression with these three types if both the stallion and the mare transmit the deleterious allele to the offspring. So then this offspring has two deleterious allele, and then the genetic disorder comes to expression. For these three disorders, DNA tests are developed, and then the KFPS, we can test if a stallion or a mare is carrier of the disease. And as long as we avoid risk matings, so carrier by carrier matings, then there is no possibility that the genetic disorder will be expressed. But there are more inbreeding problems discovered. Currently, in the news, megaesophagus and aortic rupture. Megaesophagus is a widening of the esophagus. Horses can die of it. And also aortic rupture is a common problem in Friesian horses. These problems are also discovered in humans and other horse breeds, but the thing with the Friesian horses is that it's always on the same location. So megaesophagus was found in Friesian horses, always on the same location, somewhere at the end of the esophagus. And also in Friesian horses, the rupture of the aorta was always at this same location. And therefore, the veterinarian suspected that it has some genetic background. However, it's much more difficult to research because for dwarfism and hydrocephalus, you can see when the foal is born that it has a genetic disorder. But these two disorders are inside the horse. So from outside, the horse can look really healthy. But from inside, the horse can have some megaesophagus or aortic rupture, for example. And it can also happen at a later age. So foals can be born healthy, but they can express maybe the disease at 6 months or maybe at 10 years old, then the disease can still come to expression. Next to these two, also gastric rupture is a problem in Friesian horse. And there are some suspects about fertility of the Friesian horse, that inbreeding has led to lower fertility, but there is not yet any research that has discovered this. So currently, there is a research in America, the Fenway Foundation, they are also present here, together with University of Kentucky, and they are now studying the genetic background of megaesophagus. They are also wanting to study the genetic background of aortic rupture and gastric rupture, but they are first busy with megaesophagus. They are suspecting that it's a monogenic recessive disease, and that's incomplete penetrance. So some horses which have these two deleterious alleles do not express the disease yet. they don't know yet how that is possible, but it can be because the horse can express it maybe at an even later age, or the horse is fed like grass instead of hay, and that can also lead to no expression of this disease. And they expect 50% of carriers of the Friesian horse population, but these things are not yet confirmed. And after this presentation, NZ from Fenway will also give a genetic research update. So then maybe she has something new to tell. This gave some serious things that we really need to do something about the genetic disorders in the Friesian horse. And that is why we started this research. So the aim of this research is a genetic management plan. Thereby, we will select against genetic disorders, prevent the occurrence of new genetic disorders, because that's still possible, because there is still inbreeding. We also want to conserve genetic diversity, because that is important to keep genetic improvement in the population. And our priority is the health of the Friesian horse. We want to do this all together, and that is not an easy thing to do. So therefore, we are coming with this genetic management plan. We are asking the question, is a pure breed still feasible? And what is the contribution of outcross? Is that needed to conserve this Friesian horse breed? But before we can say something about that, we first need to assess and map the current situation. So that is the content of our research. We assess the current situation. This research will contain 4 years. And it's developed in sort of 4 chapters. I will explain more in detail in the next slides. But the first thing we want to do is map the current genetic diversity. Then we want to develop a breed-specific reference genome. We also want to detect hidden lethal mutations. And we want to assess the status of known and these hidden lethal genetic disorders. By knowing all that information and combining that, we can develop such a genetic management plan. Thereby, we will select against genetic disorders and the occurrence of new disorders while conserving this genetic diversity. So the first thing is mapping the current genetic diversity based on DNA level. Thereby, we will see if there is enough genetic diversity in the Friesian horse breed to solve all these problems. And we want to estimate how much percentage of the DNA is homozygous, so sharing the same DNA from mother and father. And we can also measure the inbreeding status on the basis of DNA level. We now know, as I showed you before, the inbreeding status based on pedigree. But if you then mate, for example, brother and sister to each other, then you always get the same inbreeding level. But if you measure the inbreeding level based on DNA instead of based on pedigree, then you can more accurately see what kind and how much of the DNA is inbred, so how much DNA is shared. And then you can also get another inbreeding level between different brother and sister matings, for example. We will also see how is genetic diversity divided in the breed. Are there differences in breeding goal? Is, for example, a horse that is selected for exterior genetic different than a horse selected for sports? And how are we gonna, what are we gonna do with that in the breeding program? So how are we gonna measure the genetic diversity? Then I will first explain something about the genome of the horse. The genome is the horse consists of 64 chromosomes. These are this. And these are built up of 3 million base pairs. These base pairs are the A, C, T, and G. And of, at these base pairs and at these chromosomes, there are in total around 20,000 genes on the horse. And then this genetic variation between and within horses is the variation in base pairs. So the variation between these 3 billion A, C, T, and G. So how are we going to assess the current genetic diversity? It's not needed to just read all the 3 billion base pairs, but we have like markers for that, and that are like called SNPs. These are single nucleotide polymorphisms. And these differ between horses. So for example, you have three horses here, and this is a SNP, so this is one of these markers. For horse one, it has an A, for horse two, it has a D, and for horse three, it has a T. And then a SNP is a summary of the surrounding variation. So we know that base pairs are not inherited one by one, but base pairs are inherited of segments. So if this SNP differs, then also the base pairs around will differ. So we will use a SNP chip, and that is the Illumina Beat Chip 80K. And this 80K means that we will read 80K of these base pairs instead of the 3 billion. And with that, we can get a good insight in the genetic diversity. This will be done by VHL Genetics, one of our partners. And what we then get as results is, for example, for every horse, we get like 80K of these base pairs, and then we can read the variation of each horse and also between the horses. So for example, on this location, this horse has a GG, so it's homozygous for the G allele. Individual 2 has an AG, so it is heterozygous. And this horse has 2As, so it's homozygous for the A allele. And this horse has GA, so it's heterozygous. And there we can really see what genetic diversity is left. And this is also how more horses we have this 80K SNP data, how better we can map the genetic diversity of the Friesian horse population. So there is now an agreement from KFPS that from 2023, all foals get 80K SNP data. So we read this 80K SNP data of all foals. And around 3,500 foals are born each year. So we have a lot of information to assess the current genetic diversity. So we will use this 80K SNP data of the first year 3,500 foals. Then we can say something about the inbreeding status based on DNA level, information to map the current genetic diversity, and we can also see how much space is there to solve the problems and genetic disorders. So then the current genetic diversity is mapped. Then the next step is to look at genetic disorders in the Friesian horse population. But before that, we will develop a breed-specific reference genome. It can be quite hard to understand, but I try to keep it as simple. A genome is all genome information within an animal, and the reference genome is comparison material for the DNA of each animal. So here, if you build a genome, it has small pieces. Then these pieces are coming together, and we get a reference genome, so the comparison material for all the other DNA of the other horses. So then you have DNA from another horse and you compare it to this reference genome. Why are we doing this? The current reference genome, there is one of horses, but it's from a thoroughbred mare. And the DNA of thoroughbred horses and Friesian horses differ. So when we're using this current reference genome, then we can not really map the breed-specific variation in the Friesian horse. So if we go back, for example, if this current, this orange reference genome is from a thoroughbred horse, and we map the DNA of Friesian horses, then you can imagine that the breed-specific variation is not correctly visible here. So therefore, we need a breed-specific reference genome specific for the Friesian horse to map this breed-specific variation, and to this will also help in understanding the genetic background of some disorders. How will we do that? We will take a blood sample of one of the most influential stallions. This stallion needs to be alive because we need to have blood. And it will be an older stallion because they also have a lot of offspring, so it contributes a lot to the current population. Then we have a reference genome based on one horse. But for a high quality and a representative reference genome for the wool Friesian horse population, we will add wool genome sequencing data, so information of the wool genome of 50 other breeding stallions. And by combining this genome information of these 50 breeding stallions together with the reference genome of one influenza horse. Then we have a representative comparison material which we can use to compare the DNA of all the other Frisians. This is in contrast to this ATK SNP. You get wool genome information instead of just ATK base pairs. But it's more costly, so for genetic diversity, it's not necessary to do this. We can just do that by using this ATK SNPs. But for this reference genome, we really need this wool genome information. So then we assessed the genetic diversity and also the reference genome. Then the next step will be to detect hidden lethal mutations. Hidden lethal mutations are mutations which are not viable in the population. So that can lead, for example, to early aborted foals. It can also lead to a dead-born foal, or for example, a mare-stallion combination which does not get pregnant. Maybe something lethal is going on. How are we going to look for this? We will look at the absence of homozygous animals for a specific allele. As I explained before, every gene consists of two alleles. And for every gene, you expect all allele combinations to be present. So for this gene, you expect this allele combination to be present, this one, and also the lower two A's. But if then this A, for example, has something deleterious, so it causes something that is not viable. Most of the time, these deleterious alleles are only expressed if a horse contains two deleterious alleles. So for example, if this leads to something not viable, then you expect this allele combination not to be present in the population simply because it's lethal. So we are gonna look for these absence of some homozygous animals for specific genes. Then we use this genotype data of these ATK SNPs. And you can imagine if it just genotype like 10 animals, for example, there is a very big chance that by coincidence we don't find any homozygous animals for a specific gene. But for example, if you have like the around 4,000 foals, then if we don't see homozygous animals for a specific gene, then it is much more likely to say that it's not viable. And in 2023, we have like around 35 to 4,000 foals. But when we start this, we will have around 7,000 or 8,000 foals with genotype data. So if we don't find for a specific gene any homozygous animals here, then we will suspect that there is something lethal going on. And then by the use of this reference genome, we can also look which genes are responsible for that and which horses are carry these alleles. VHL Genetics, our partner, can develop genetic tests for these lethal mutations. So the same as they did for dwarfism and hydrocephalus, they can also develop genetic tests for lethal mutations. And these can be expressed on these ATK SNP data. So if we have ATK SNP data false, we will also know if they have these lethal mutations or not. Then the last step will be to assess the current status of known and hidden genetic disorders. So then we will map the frequencies of all known and also these hidden lethal genetic disorders in the population. Then we will see, are deleterious alleles linked to positive characteristics? Some people are suspecting that, but now we are not yet sure. But it could be that the Frisian horse, carrier of dwarfism, for example, maybe it performs better in sports. We do not know that yet, but if that is the case, then if we select against dwarfism, we automatically select against the sports. So we really need to consider, test this, and then consider what are we going to do this with this in a breeding goal. And we know most disorders are connective tissue related. So these are related to collagen. And we wanted to look, are these disorders linked to each other? So for example, megaesophagus and gastric rupture, are these disorders linked to each other? We do not yet know that, but Fenway Foundation is indeed researching the genetic background. And if we know that, then we can also look in the relationships of these genetic disorders. And we will look, is a disorder more severe if a Friesian horse contains several disorders? So is, for example, megaesophagus, is that more severe if the Friesian horse, for example, also carries dwarfism gene? And this is also very important in if we develop this genetic management plan, how we are gonna deal with this. So how to implement it is this in a future breeding program. We will assess the DNA profile of the Friesian horse with its reference genome, but also with the foals with the ATK SNP data. We can add specific markers for genetic disorders to this ATK SNP data, as I said, if we know new genetic disorders and the underlying background, we can test with the foals. If we have the ATK SNP data, we can also say, okay, this foal is carrier of this and this disease. It's also very important to conserve genetic diversity, because that is the thing that is important for genetic progress in the Friesian horse population, and also to keep the Friesian horse population healthy. And we can measure with this the inbreeding status based on DNA level, which is much more accurate than the inbreeding status based on pedigree information. And when we have all this information, our first aim is to solve the issues within the purebred Friesian horse. We will develop a roadmap. Where will the focus be? We for sure, yeah, we want to select against all genetic disorders at the same time, but that's simply not possible. For example, if the frequency of one genetic disorder is 5%, if we then eliminate all carriers of this specific disorder, then we eliminate 34% of the total Friesian horse population. But this is just for one genetic disorder, and we know that there are many disorders present. So we cannot simply not eliminate all carriers of the disease. So we will develop such a roadmap, and thereby we prioritize the selection based on the severity and the frequency of these genetic disorders. And thereby we also take into account if disorders are linked to positive characteristics, or if disorders are linked to each other, for example, the collagen disorders. And thereby we aim to conserve this genetic diversity, because this is really important and needed to keep this Friesian horse population healthy. Are there any questions?